Welcome to our Facebook gathering of worship. This week, as you can tell, we are having to do things differently, friends. And so I am standing right now in the Memorial Presbyterian Church Sanctuary with Gina Miller, who you just heard on the organ, and later we'll get the chance to hear Pat Breeding welcoming you. As you go through this service, I will invite you, if you have the bulletin in front of you, to open it up, and as you feel comfortable, sing along with the music offerings we lift up. But at this moment, let us come into this space, lifting up ourselves with our opening. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. God's presence is in this space, and it is with you wherever you are watching from. The word of the Lord says this: I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. I declare that your steadfast love is established forever, and your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Psalms 89, verses 1 through 2. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we hadn't planned on giving up this much during Lent. We thought we'd be gathered in worship together, able to meet for coffee during the week, sharing lunch at Lent lunches. It's not the Lent we had planned, but it's the one we have been given. So, Lord, in this time, give us more than we ever imagined. Lord, help us not to give up for Lent. Give us the resources, relationships, and reality checks we need to carry on and continue to walk with us. Amen. Our scripture text for this morning comes from Mark 12, 28 through 44. One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that he had answered them well, he asked him, "Which commandment is first of all?" And Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O God, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength.' The second is this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. And then the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said, 'He is the one, and besides him, there is no other.'" To love him with all the heart and with all the understanding and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, this is much more important than the whole of burnt offerings and sacrifices. And when Jesus saw, he answered him wisely. He said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared ask him any question. And while Jesus was teaching in the temple, he said, "How can the scribes say that the Messiah is the son of David? David himself, by the Holy Spirit, declared, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet.' David himself calls him Lord. So how can he be his son?" And the large crowd was listening with delight. And he taught, he said, "Beware of the scribes who will walk around in long robes and be greeted with respect in marketplaces and have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They will devour widows' houses and for the sake of appearance say long prayers. They will receive greater condemnation." He sat down opposite of the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. And many rich people put in large sums. And a poor widow came and put in 2 small copper coins, which are worth a penny. And then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she gave out of her poverty and has put in everything she had, all she had to live on." This is the word of the Lord. Amen. Thanks be to God. Dear friends, thank you so much for joining me today. This, as you know, is an uncharted world that we are living in right now, and many difficult decisions have been made. And many of our community leaders have struggled with what to do in this time. You've struggled with what to do. Our face-to-face worship services have paused, and we've moved to online platforms such as this. Our social gatherings have been suspended for now. And I know that many of you have chosen to self-quarantine, which has left you dramatically cut off from the communities you hold dear. For those of you who can't self-quarantine, you've had to find ways to be extra vigilant about your health. It helps to gather. It helps to be with one another. It helps to define sacred spaces and live into those spaces. And yet, with much pain, we have had to consider what it means to be the body of Christ when the pews just can't hold us anymore. We are in this together. Today's text is quite familiar to many of us. It's the most recognizable rule of living. Love God, love your neighbor as yourself. But as I have been sitting with this text this week, I think it is hitting me in new and refreshed ways. For a time when distance is the key to life, this commandment to love God and love neighbor speaks to the realness and the holiness of our interdependence on God and on one another. The truth of this command to love God is that we rely on God for everything. We go to God for all of our needs. We need God. We are dependent upon God. We need the sureness of Christ in our life. And our interdependence then extends beyond God to one another. We are hashtag better together. And we are learning just how much we truly depend on each other. We depend on one another to stay healthy. We depend on one another to call us, to keep us connected. We depend on one another in ways we never even imagined. We depend on people to see us and love us in ways that mean letting go of what is comfortable. Perhaps this is the most real way we can look at our world right now, as a holy threshold that we are invited into. In this temporary and new world, we have the opportunity to decide what type of community we will be. We have the chance to set up a new community, a true community of Christ, one that relies on one another in radical ways, in real, tangible ways. During this time, I believe we are being called to love God and love one another in ways we never could have imagined. We are being called into interdependence on God, to give up our way of doing life and receive God's new life. We are being called to notice our own interdependence on one another. This really isn't the time to hole up in your own homes, bunker down, and isolate yourselves from one another. This is the time to cry out, "I am not alone." Pick up a phone and tell your friends that you care. This is the time to cling to the reality that we are in this together and to cling to that holy interdependence. How we use this time to deepen our faith, to deepen our time, to deepen ourselves, that will speak volumes to the world. At the end of the text, Christ points to a widow who puts all that she has into the offering plate. And while those with lots are putting in a few dollars here and there, she gives her last two pennies. I think this is how we approach the next few weeks. Because church is not a transactional function. It's not a place we go to get what we need, to put in only so much and then walk away from. Church is deeply relational, spiritual, and connectional. And so I want to ask you, what makes a space holy? I believe that our worship, our spaces, and our communities are holy when a deep love for God and for our neighbor is practiced. And so I challenge you now. Are you in this with me? Amen. Today, for our prayers of the people, we're going to do this a little differently. You have in your bulletin a list of prayers that you can follow along with. I invite you to email any extra prayers or even put them down in the comments if you feel like that should be shared. But as we get to each section, I will pause and let you take a moment in your own space to lift up those prayers that you have. Let's pray. To you, O Lord, we lift our souls. O God, in you we trust. Almighty God, our refuge and strength, in this time of disruption, uncertainty, and fear, would you be our refuge, our calm, our healer? Together we lift up the following: all those who are ill, all those who are afraid, all those who are unsure of where to turn and what to do, all medical and healthcare providers as they respond to the need in front of them and prepare for what may come. All those engaged in medical research, preparing vaccines and further measures to respond to illness, to give them wisdom, energy, stamina. All leaders, political, social, spiritual, that they may be empowered and gifted to lead with truth, wisdom, and grace. All employers and employees, as workspaces and tasks are disrupted. All school children, teachers, parents, as they adjust to what is being asked of them. All those who are hungry. All those who are on the edge of financial stability. Each nation, as they move to care for their people and for the world. As we join our voices together, even though distant from one another, we know and trust you hear us. May your presence be palpable to each person this day as you lead them in peace and generous love. Jesus Christ, lover of all, bring healing, bring peace. Amen. And now, as you are willing, I invite you to either listen or sing along, if you are so bold, to this familiar hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. As we go from this space, I invite you into our benediction. We go nowhere by accident. Wherever we go, God is sending us. Wherever we are, God has put us there. He has a purpose for us being there. Christ lives in us and has something he wants to do through us. We believe this and go in his grace, his love, and his power. Amen.